Welcome, friends. In this talk, I wanted to give you an idea how game theory can be used to model the effect of human behavior on the spread of infectious diseases. In particular, I will show that multiple waves of the COVID-19 pandemic that we have observed can be attributed to rational human behavior. Let's get started. This talk is based on a project done in collaboration with Fola Augusta and many others. Paula is amazing, and she's a true heart and soul behind the project. I am just a hack who Paula somehow confused with an expert in game theory. The COVID-19 pandemic has had a tremendous toll on the humanity, with 145 million cases worldwide reported and more than 3 million deaths worldwide. It is caused by the novel coronavirus, and like with many viruses, there is no good pharmaceutical treatment against this disease. Until the recent approval of several vaccines for emergency use, the only way to slow the spread of the COVID-19 was to limit the contact between individuals. This was achieved through workspace and school closures, as well as social distancing rules. However, the success of such measures is based on the population compliance. Some individuals zealously follow all guidelines, while others only pretend to do so. We have even observed a wide variety of outright stupid behavior, such as throwing coronavirus parties. And, as always, a non-trivial part of the population refuses to believe in reality. They believe it is yet another government hoax. So I hope I convinced you that a realistic model of COVID-19 transmission should include human factor. And the effect of human behavior on the transmission of an infectious disease is studied by behavioral epidemiology. Epidemiology is based on deterministic mathematical models of disease spread and transmission. But the human factor can be accounted by game-theoretic models of rational human behavior. The strategies that the individual chooses in the game depend on the state of the pandemic, but these choices also affect the spread of the disease. And so this results in a coupled model with this feedback loop, where the state of the disease affects the rational choices of humans, but those rational choices in turn affect the progression of the spread of the disease. I am going to illustrate this modeling approach using a model of dynamic human behavior in response to the COVID-19 pandemic. I already admitted that I'm just a hack, so everything I do is as simple as 1, 2, 3. I will walk you through 3 stages of constructing and solving this model. First, we are going to construct a pure epidemiological model, which is going to be a compartmental model of COVID-19 transmission. Let's start with the simplest SIR model. The entire population is split into 3 homogeneous compartments: susceptible individuals, infected individuals, and removed individuals. Removed individuals comprise both recovered individuals and diseased individuals. The arrows indicate flows between the compartments. For example, susceptible individuals can get infected and they become infected individuals, and eventually they either recover or die from the disease. The rate of flow from the susceptible compartment to the infected compartment is usually called force of infection. It is usually assumed to be proportional to the number of infected individuals in a population. The dynamics of such systems in time are usually described by the systems of ordinary differential equations. We can refine the basic SIR model and include an exposed compartment. These are individuals who have been exposed to the disease, but they have not yet become infectious. Also, this model assumes a closed population. We disregard any birth or natural death processes because we are interested in the short-term dynamic of this pandemic. Because the total population size remains constant in this model, we usually assume it is equal to 1, and the sizes of the compartments correspond to the frequencies of the corresponding individuals. Next refinement is to split all infectious individuals into two independent compartments. One consists of asymptomatically infected individuals, and the other consists of symptomatically infected individuals. This is certainly the case with COVID-19, and it is important to make this distinction for the future human behavior model, because asymptomatically infected individuals usually do not know that they're infected. Here is a final refinement of this model for COVID-19 transmission. We include two additional compartments which consist of quarantined and hospitalized individuals. Hospitalized individuals are those infected individuals that require intensive care in a hospital. And quarantined individuals are those who know they're infected, but they are asked to quarantine themselves. There are arrows that also go back from H compartment to I compartment and from Q compartment to I compartment. There is also a flow from H compartment to I compartment, which corresponds to hospital discharge rates. And there is a flow from Q compartment to I compartment, which corresponds to the quarantine violation rate. We assume that these rates are not affected by the human behavior, and so they are parameters of the pure epidemiological model. This model with seven compartments results in a system of seven ordinary differential equations. These equations describe the dynamics of the COVID-19 transmission. Note that susceptible individuals become exposed to the disease when they come in contact with symptomatically infected individuals or asymptomatically infected individuals or quarantined or hospitalized individuals. These four compartments comprise all infectious individuals. Also, each of these four classes has its own recovery rate and the COVID-19-induced death rate. The parameters of this epidemiological model were calibrated to fit the data of COVID-19 transmission in Arizona. This purely epidemiological model can be used to demonstrate the effect of quarantine and hospitalization. The left pane shows what happens if we double the quarantine and hospitalization rates. This corresponds to the dashed lines. This results in lower peaks of the pandemic, and it spreads the pandemic more evenly over time, so there is less stress on the healthcare system. The pane on the right shows what happens if quarantine violation rates and hospital discharge rates are doubled. This results in a higher pandemic peak, and we definitely want to avoid that. Next, let's set up a dynamic game model of rational human behavior as a response to the COVID-19 pandemic. So what do we need to set up a game? There are three ingredients. We need players, strategies that these players can use, and the outcomes of these choices. I am going to set up two separate games. In one game, the players are going to be the susceptible individuals. In the second game, the players are going to be symptomatically infected individuals. The susceptible individuals are driven by the desire to avoid getting infected. Therefore, they can choose to either support school and workplace closures or oppose these closures. On the other hand, symptomatically infected individuals cannot help themselves, but they are driven by their consciousness and they want to avoid infecting other individuals. So their choice is to either self-isolate or not self-isolate. Of course, to make informed strategic choices, individuals need to understand the consequences of these choices. If susceptible individual chooses not to support workspace or school closures, then they face the risk of infection. And this risk is based on the current disease prevalence. But if they choose to support closures, then they face accumulating socioeconomic losses. Infected individuals who choose not to self-isolate face the burden of harming other individuals, and this burden is proportional to the current disease mortality. On the other hand, individuals who elect to self-isolate face the burden of isolation from the society. First, let me walk you through the setup of the game for susceptible individuals. Our modeling approach was adopted from the following preprint. Let's denote by X sub S the proportion of susceptible individuals that support closure. Also, C is a time-varying function that reflects the impact of the closure measures. It has only two states. The closure measures are either enacted or not enacted. If the measures are not enacted, then there is zero effect, and if they are enacted, then we assume that there is a non-trivial reduction in the transmission rate. The closure measures are enacted as long as at least half of the susceptible population support the measures, and if at least a certain time has passed since the beginning of the pandemic. The closure measures are turned off as soon as more than half of the susceptible population stops supporting these measures. So this impact function is used as a factor to reduce the transmission of the disease. To make a rational choice, susceptible individuals weigh the potential payoffs of each strategy. Individuals who oppose closure face the risk of infection, so their payoff is proportional to the current disease prevalence, and it is multiplied by the sensitivity parameter to getting infected. Notice that these individuals only account for perceived disease prevalence because nobody knows how many individuals are infected asymptomatically. Individuals who choose to support closure measures face accumulating socioeconomic losses. Their payoff also depends on their sensitivity to such losses. Individuals who oppose closures switch to supporting closures at the rate proportional to the payoff gain resulting from this switch. Scaling payoffs by a non-zero constant does not affect the outcome of the game, so we divide this expression by pi over s, and we effectively replace two sensitivity parameters with one single sensitivity parameter, which measures sensitivity to socioeconomic losses relative to the sensitivity of getting infected. Individuals change their closure support behavior according to the so-called imitation dynamics. Individuals who oppose closure sample the behavior of the individuals who support closure and vice versa. The rate of interactions between these two types of individuals is proportional to the product of their frequencies, and the rate at which individuals switch their behavior is proportional to that payoff gain. Also, kappa S is the social learning rate in this case. This parameter describes how fast individuals are willing to switch their behavior. Socioeconomic losses also accumulate with time. The longer the lockdown measures are in place, the greater these losses become. The rate of change of this function is modeled using the exponential fading memory mechanism. These losses accumulate only when the lockdown measures in place, namely when C of T is not equal to zero, but past losses decay with time. Next, let's set up the game for infected individuals' support for self-isolation. Xi denotes the proportion of infected individuals that decide to self-isolate, and we assume that these individuals do not contribute to the spread of the disease. So we have this adjustment factor of 1 minus Xi on the proportion of symptomatically infected individuals in the force of infection term. Once again, to make informed rational decisions, individuals need to weigh potential payoffs resulting from each of the choices. This part is a completely novel model that we constructed in this project. And the key observation here is that infected individuals cannot help themselves. But if they are conscientious, they will want to protect other individuals. If an infected individual decides not to self-isolate, then this individual faces the burden of infecting others. This burden is proportional to the current COVID-19-induced death rates, And we choose this metric because these data are usually publicly available. And there is also a parameter which describes the sensitivity to infecting others. In other words, it measures how conscious you are. If an infected individual does elect to self-isolate, then they face the burden of social isolation. However, unlike the closure measures, which may be enacted for a long time, these isolation measures stay in place only as long as an individual is infected. Because this happens on a much shorter time scale, we assume that these losses are constant and they are represented by the sensitivity to social isolation parameter. Similarly to the support closure game, we use imitation dynamics to describe how individuals switch their self-isolation behavior. The rate of change in infected individuals who elect to self-isolate is proportional to the sampling rate between self-isolating individuals and non-self-isolating individuals. It is also proportional to the payoff gain resulting from this switch. Similarly to the first game-theoretic model, we have one single sensitivity parameter which represents sensitivity to social isolation relative to infecting others. And we have a social learning rate for infected individuals, which represents how fast these individuals are willing to switch their behavior. Now, let's couple the epidemiological model with two dynamic games of human behavior. The coupled model now consists of 9 equations, because we have an extra equation that describes the change in support of the closure behavior. The second extra equation describes the change in the socioeconomic losses function. And the third extra equation describes the change in the self-isolation behavior. Also, the proportion of individuals who support closures and who self-isolate affect the force of infection term. Now, let's analyze the results of this model, which we obtained by running this dynamical system through a MATLAB ODE solver. In this illustration, the left pane corresponds to the proportion of symptomatically infected individuals, and the right pane corresponds to the proportion of susceptible individuals who support closure. These figures isolate the effect of the closure support behavior. We assume that infected individuals do not self-isolate at all. The 3 graphs in each pane correspond to different starting conditions. These conditions correspond to the initial propensity of the population to support the closure measures. First, let's look at the red lines. If the initial support for closures is low, then it takes a long time for these measures to be enacted. This is the right pane. Look at the left pane. This results in an early peak of the pandemic. Next, let's look at the green lines. If the population enthusiastically supports the closure measures from the very beginning, then they are enacted quickly, but individuals get tired of these measures. As you see in the right pane, the support for these measures quickly dwindles down. Looking at the left pane, this also results in a fairly high peak of the pandemic. Let's go back to the right pane. Individuals realize, wait a minute, what have we done? So they start supporting the closure measures again, but it's already too late by that point. Finally, let's look at the blue lines. It corresponds to the just right conditions from the Goldilocks story. The initial support for closure measures is there, but it's somewhat lukewarm, so these measures are not enacted too quickly. Yet, they are enacted just in time to suppress the first peak of the pandemic, look at the left pane. But then the support slowly starts to decrease, which turns off the measures. This results in a second bigger peak, but the population rebounds back pretty quickly and supports the closure measures one more time. This allows to avoid large peaks of the pandemic. The second illustration isolates the effect of the self-isolation behavior. Here, we assume that nobody supports workspace or school closures. The result here is very straightforward. The more conscientious individuals we have in a society, the lower the peak of the pandemic and the later it occurs. Next, we are going to take a default model, which accounts for both closure support and self-isolation behaviors. In the right pane, the black lines correspond to susceptible individuals who support the closures, and the red lines correspond to infected individuals who elect to self-isolate. In the left pane, the solid red line demonstrates two large waves of the infection. This situation corresponds to low social learning rate of the infected individuals, and this can be overcome by the higher social learning rate, which corresponds to the dashed line. However, high social learning rate for the infected individuals may result in multiple waves of the infection if the social learning rate of susceptible individuals is low. Yet these multiple waves of infections can be mitigated by increasing quarantine and hospitalization rates. The dashed lines correspond to five-fold increase in these rates, and as you can see from the left pane, we no longer have these multiple waves of infection. What conclusions can we draw from this model? First, increasing quarantine and hospitalization rates is important because it reduces the disease burden and the epidemic peaks. If infected individuals adopt positive behavior quickly, this leads to the reduced disease burden, but it may lead to multiple waves of the infection if at the same time susceptible individuals are slow to learn positive behavior. High quarantine violation and hospital discharge rates amplify infection peaks, and they can lead to multiple infection waves that persist in the community. Finally, increasing quarantine and hospitalization rates is important because it can prevent multiple persisting waves of infections. What did I want to achieve with this presentation? I hope I persuaded you that to combat such disasters as the COVID-19 pandemic, we should respect each other and work as a team. Even if this is the only thing that you will get out of this presentation, then I will consider my mission fulfilled. Thank you for your attention.